So I want to start by, I guess, asking you what you see as the most important legacy of the French Revolution. I think lots of people kind of broadly know that, of course, the revolution toppled the French monarchy, laid the groundwork for liberal democracy in Europe, of course, served as an inspiration for the Haitian Revolution, and then a little later, partly an inspiration for the Russian Revolution. But I guess my question for you is, can we see the influence of the revolution anywhere unexpected? Or maybe another way of putting it is, what is something about the French Revolution that you wish more people on the left knew about?
I will try to not only seduce those who are already convinced, but I think one should do this respectfully. Seduce, or at least confuse, those who may be sincere liberals, but they are nonetheless kind of bombarded by this message. Yeah, maybe they meant well, but they got into a deadlock, absolute terror, indistinct killing, and so on. So it's nonetheless the root, the elementary form of Stalinist terror, and so on and so on. I think they should be redeemed. I would even go as far as to say that in some things we should even return to them, to the French revolutionaries, in comparison with even with Marxist experience. There was something unique about that moment. My first advice, sorry if this will be a little bit boring, but my first advice to those benevolent skeptics, you know, like, yeah, they tried to do good things, egalitarianism, but look where they ended in terror and so on. It's, let's get, now I've been talked like a good positivist, why not? Let's get the facts straight. I spoke with some historians in France, in English, who told me, hey, terror, listen, don't compare this with Nazi or Stalinist terror. When they had political trials, it was not as it is usually portrayed, it was just a formality, you were condemned in advance. When you were accused by a revolutionary tribunal, do you know that the percentage of how often you were found guilty was around 60%? So it was 60 to 40. You had a fair chance of surviving. Second point, many of these accusations, irrational and so on, ask now honest, even liberal, not pro-Jacobin, British historians who had a look into, because the good thing about United Kingdom is they were never properly bombed, blah, blah, they had most of their documents kept. The data about the interaction of English government with French revolutionaries, you know that, for example, the accusation against Danton and the killing of Danton is usually considered as the first moment of the great madness of revolutionary terror. Sorry, he was guilty. It is clear from the British secret documents, now they became accessible, that Danton was all the time systematically bribed by the British government to pursue. So, second thing, the beheading of the king and queen. Sorry, they revolutionaries wanted to give him a chance, but while he was not even in prison, just isolated in his castle, the king, the royal family were constantly plotting with the enemies who were attacking France of how to overthrow the French government. So they were simply guilty. Terror, numbers of terror. My God, according to some data, Thermidor, when ooh, the terror was over, people were dancing on the streets and so on. No, in the first 2, 3 weeks of the Thermidor terror, after Saint-Just and Robespierre were arrested and liquidated, more people were guillotined than almost the entire era of the revolutionary terror before. You know what was the only difference? You should look upon it closely. Who was guillotined? The point is, of course, that under Jacobins, it was visible names, nobles and so on. What made them visible? We don't even hear or have precise statistics of the ordinary low people who were beheaded and so on and so on. The last thing, this is my ultimate argument against those who claim, oh, it was a terrorist dictatorship. Sorry, but whatever you say about Robespierre, he was not an idiot. One should maybe find those documents which demonstrate this. I know they exist. Some historians showed them to me. Do you know that Robespierre again and Saint-Just were not idiots? They saw it coming, the gradual organization in the Assemblée Nationale, National Assembly, of a new coalition to oust, to throw out the Jacobins. And they were, if anything, they were too procedural, liberal. They didn't want to do a simple coup d'etat to introduce direct terror. No, it was quite tragically naive. In the days before Thermidor, Robespierre was seen walking along the River Seine in Paris, just thinking about his speech. For him, the medium where he will win was not arrest the counter-revolutionaries and so on. It was a big speech in Assemblée Nationale. And it failed. He was overthrown by a simple majority of votes. I'm sorry, that's not how you overthrow this true totalitarian dictator and so on and so on. If anything, Robespierre was very moderate. He knew, he was aware of the danger of the terror exploding into madness. And his last writings were full of double fear or suspicion. One is how to gradually bring the terror to the end. And second, maybe his deepest insight. And here I see the proper greatness of Robespierre, of Saint-Just and some others. You know, they were not idiots. They were aware of what Marxists later conceptualized as the gradual shift from republican form to some form of personal dictatorship, Bonapartism. And they were aware that, again, this will in all probability happen. And they even debated this temptation. Should we become the new Bonaparte? And we will control the situation, blah, blah. And it's one of the most beautiful ethical gestures, my God. They concluded, no, sorry, it's better for us to lose our physical head than to take that path. And the step from Robespierre to Napoleon is an important step. Let me give you just one proof, which is for me maybe the most sublime moment. You may know that my big fixation is Haiti revolution. I even have a theory, as you already mentioned it, that French Revolution only became a world historical model through its repetition in Haiti. That was the test, that a totally different race, cultural group recognized itself in it. And here you measure who was truly progressive. For example, Hegel, who is supposed to be more conservative, in a wonderful footnote to his philosophy of right, I think, he praises Haiti as an example of how even a nation which is not part of Western European enlightened people can successfully establish a modern state. So for me, the single most sublime moment is, you know the story, when still before Thermidor, the Toussaint Louverture, the ruling new circle in Haiti, sent a delegation to Assemblée Nationale. They were celebrated, immediately recognized as equals. Then things changed with Napoleon. Napoleon did something very nasty there. He sent the army, I think it was his brother Joseph, who was the head, the general, with the explicit goal of not only bringing order there, re-establish slavery, but as he said, Napoleon, no, this is such a dangerous precedent that all the slaves there should be killed and new slaves brought. It's not enough just to control the situation. And now comes, for me, one of those every revolutionary should know them, an incredibly moving moment. An important part of Napoleon's army were Polish soldiers. And they did something incredible. They were approaching the revolutionary Black Army. And when they approached it, they heard some singing. And they thought, this must be some stupid tribal songs and so on. And then when they approached more, they saw the rebels, the blacks, are singing Marseillaise. Mm-hmm. You know what happened? The French soldiers said, wait a minute, are we here fighting on the right side? They changed sides, they rejoined the black. That's why, very interesting, that's why when later, in 1804, I think, when the revolution deviated a little bit and the first king or whatever emperor after Toussaint Louverture ordered kill all white people. I have two explanations here, not justifications, but explanations. Firstly, that nonetheless, he explicitly exempted white people of Polish origins. Mm-hmm. He said they saved us, Poles should survive. Second thing, you know how I understand this kill all white people? This is exactly the moment when the Black Revolution started to imitate, they want to copy the white power structure. They wanted to be the new ruling class and so on and so on. So it's not, oh, they went so far, they wanted to kill all the white people. No, this was imminently a reactionary moment, an attempt to reestablish the old power structure only with then a deposition of power. But I think now I will stop, but just this. Do you remember, my God, Haiti is with us, this nation, for being the first who took independence clearly, for being, and that's where I'm wrongly accused of Eurocentrism, for being more European than we Europeans, if by European we mean what is best in our legacy, equality, blah, blah. They were only through them, again, French Revolution became a world historical event, which, here I follow my friend Jean-Claude Milner, who is not exactly a radical leftist, but here he is right, who says, sorry, American Revolution was never such an authentic emancipatory event. Even now, it's an unfinished revolution. It drags on. That's why American Revolution, in a nice polemics against Hannah Arendt, Milner develops this, how American Revolution was always a compromise. Lincoln, again, it didn't succeed. You can tell Ku Klux Klan and so on and so on. So again, just to conclude, but you can then ask me more, what I would like to point out is that We live in an era, so it seems, well, these are old romantic dreams, oh, people gather, sorry, we live in a complex digitalized society, it's no longer time for such things. No, I think that today, with the crisis that we are approaching, and now it's clear that COVID will not disappear. There will be other pandemics. Global warming is becoming reality, and so on and so on. We are approaching an emergency state. Mm-hmm. And sooner or later, it may take 10 years, but then we will pay the price. It probably will take 10, 15 years. Something will have to happen. It's simply the only way out. First, voluntarism. In a progressive sense, like we cannot justify measures of how to reorient our production to fit the ecological goals, protecting environment. You cannot ground this in some objective necessity of productive forces. We simply should act, even if it's again the market logic. Second point. Egalitarianism, even those in power has to pay now lip service to it. We fight pandemic, the goal should be not protected bubbles, but universal healthcare. Then, I know what I'm saying here, elements of progressive terror, I don't mean secret police grabbing you, but when you have a pandemic, when you have nature in chaos, you have to control the situation. And fourth element, as a counterpoint to the third one, trust in the people, which means precisely more than this. Every 4 years, you have election, and then corruption takes on, and so on, and so on. It was already clear in fighting the pandemic that the best countries, still now at least, the best in dealing with the pandemic, were those where the state could rely on the people. For example, although now they have a little bit higher number, but the miracle till 2 months ago was Vietnam. Mm-hmm. They didn't have enough vaccines or whatever. They have excellent local self-organization. These four features, voluntarism, egalitarianism, terror in good sense, and trust in the people, this will be needed. This is needed in emergency states. So I think again that something like the way the Jacobins acted, of course, in different conditions, but this basic logic will have to be reinvented if we mean it seriously coping with not just one catastrophe. Pandemic, it will be another pandemic, it will be ecological catastrophe, and so on and so on. There is no return to normality. We will need this type of radical measures. I'm here on Lenin's side. People are often telling me, but you are critical of Lenin sometimes. I say maybe, but the only Lenin I really don't like, and I hope you also, is Lenin Moreno, the president of I think that what has to be done now cannot be formulated in this, for my taste, a little bit too trustful standard Marxist notion. Relations of production are forces of production, blah blah. No, as we should act not literally, but in the spirit of what Lenin did. He saw out of all these standard evolutionary Marxist formulas an opportunity for the revolution. Remember that Mensheviks were not some bad guys. Okay, they were, but basically they were simply old-fashioned orthodox Marxists. When Marx said, you remember, when Marx said, one thing is certain, I'm not a Marxist. I think precisely Mensheviks. Their idea was, don't dream about the revolution now, the situation is not yet ripe, we first have to enact the passage to bourgeois democracy in an orderly way, and so on and so on. No, we cannot play this game today. We should act in a voluntarist way and a little bit faster. I've spoken too long. Please, put on, at least now, Eugene, put on your stupid black leather.
Actually, I'm going to hand the leather over to Paul.
So, and speaking of that, what do you think we can learn from about the nature of counter-revolution and reaction from the experience of the French Revolution and even the Haitian Revolution? What does it teach us about the nature of counter-revolution?
First, the usual thing is to say that the Jacobins were too radical, they should have been looking for a pact and so on. But you know, it's the same as with October Revolution. It's often said that they could have predominated in a more peaceful, organic way, that it is the Red Terror which caused them the counter-revolution, civil war. Look, it's not so simple. Can we even imagine today the tremendous pressure under which France was in 1892, early 93, and then Soviet Union in 1918, beginning of 1919. In both cases, the central government controlled, I think, around only 1/7 of the territory of the state. And this was not just like in Vendée, some primitive farmers rebelling and so on. Concerning future Soviet Union, you know which book is the absolute one to read? It's difficult to get today. An English general joined Kolchak, the Siberian counter-revolution, the most dangerous one who covered till Ural, all that big Asian part of Soviet Union, and he wrote his memoirs after the war, observations. And the image you get there is a terrifying one. Against these accusations of, you know, communists are usually anti-Semitic, sorry. The first thing Kolchak did in his domain was to start reprinting like crazy Protocols of Zion and claiming this is a Judeo-Bolshevik plot. At that point already, it originated, you know, this caricature of Trotsky as a devil, Jewish devil, and so on and so on. And he, this British general, I'm so sorry, I forgot, his name slipped out of my mind. He also described in detail what the white counter-revolutionary did when they occupied a territory. Incredible purges, much more brutal than those of the Bolsheviks when they reoccupied, at the end, this territory. Massive killing, restoration of land to the previous owners, and so on and so on. So it absolutely wasn't just the Bolshevik brutality. No, it was much more complex. It was also that farmers, like, okay, say, Bolsheviks, we don't trust them, okay, let the white people, let the counter-revolution come. And then the situation for them got much worse. And they almost effectively welcomed back the Bolshevik land, the Bolshevik forces. Because, you know, you should not forget that at that point, Lenin's formula was not collectivization. It was land to the farmers. And Bolsheviks did that. It was an ingenious move. Lenin, to the end of his life, warned against the deadlock of too fast a privatization. You know who follows Lenin here? My good friend, I'm proud to say, although we met only two times, my good friend Alvaro Garcia Linera, the Bolivian vice president, who said that Lenin, and the term we coined together in debate is principled pragmatic stance. You have a principled stance. We know communist horizon and so on. But then in how to actualize this principled stance, You have to be very cautious. Don't alienate people who are not really your enemies. And Lenin was here incredibly open. I read some documents on how, you know, after the Civil War, many Western high corporate managers, Rockefeller even, I don't know who the kind, came to visit Soviet Union, and Lenin was fascinated with them. He saw in them masters of how to coordinate, organize large factories, all the complexity. He saw an emancipatory potential in them. And the same miracle was accomplished by Morales, Linera, and now Lucho Arce in Bolivia. They were radical, but in a very careful way. They didn't screw it up. When people ask me, okay, whenever radical left came to power, they screwed it up. I'm very sorry, in Bolivia, they did not screw it up. The real purchase power of ordinary worker in the, how much was it, 9-10 years of Morales' first reign, more than redoubled. They succeeded in controlling the big capital, but at the same time, exploiting it in the sense of making it work for them. This is very important for us today. And I think this is what we need today. And this is where Jacobins come. Why do I still prefer Jacobins a little bit over Lenin? Was that not in his practice, but in his theory. Lenin was, for me, a little bit too much of an idealist and at the same time historical determinist. You know, like in Orthodox Marxism, he still thought history is on our side, there are phases of history, we just accomplish a task predetermined by history and so on. While Robespierre and Saint-Just use some wonderful metaphors here, where they say, no, revolution is like you are on wild sea, on a boat, and you don't have any maps, any compasses, orientation, you have to improvise, and so on, and so on. They were much more aware, and we should be aware of this open situation, how to reorganize things, we have to improvise, and so on, and so on. Lenin, in his practice, was fully aware of this. So, to answer to your question, I think there is, and this is how great progressive revolutionaries ask, yes, ultimately, you have to maintain power. No bullshitting here. But at the same time, that you don't make compromises about who is in power and so on, you should not create unnecessary enemies. You should look at things rationally. Like, we have there some very efficient big corporations. How to control them, but not ruin the production? How to make them work for us? Or, as Lenin was aware, new economic policy. How to? He was well aware that state cannot provide this small level production of consumerist goods. So let's use them. It can be controlled, and so on and so on. That's, I think, how you really fight a counter-revolution. By this mixture of, on the one hand, at the principle level, no compromises. But you should nonetheless give those who are in principle your opponents, you should give them a chance, like obey our rules, contribute to the welfare of the nation, and okay, we tolerate a certain level of your wealth, and so on and so on. It can be done. Again, of all the countries, Bolivia proved that it can be done. Now people tell me, right-wingers, but look at Haiti, even now, you remember a week ago or when the prime minister killed and so on. That's the curse of Haiti. It's a nightmare how this country, for just doing this at that point, making a revolution, and as some people deployed very nicely, all European modernity, that's its paradox, was filled in, full of the ideas of freedom, freedom against slavery, but they mostly meant slavery in this metaphoric sense. As a worker, you are a slave. At home, a woman maybe is a slave, blah, blah, blah. But at the same time, they didn't write a lot about literal slavery, which was exploding in early stages of capitalism. And again, in Haiti, they did this. That's why they had to be punished. And they were punished for 200 years.